Hello and welcome to another edition of the webinar series, Starstruck, episode 14. I'm Anand, your host this evening for a great conversation, and hope you all had a great week. Or if it was like the week that wasn't, then hold on. Our guest this evening will really ensure that your weekend will start on a great note. We all are extremely happy to have with us today a TV anchor, a theater personality, comedian, a political satirist, columnist, podcaster, author, and whatnot. Plus, it's his birthday today. Please welcome Cyrus Brocha.
Thank you. Thank you, Anand. Thank you very
Hi,
much.
Hi, Cyrus.
I'm playing music in the background to introduce myself.
And I'm just a very, very happy birthday first. Thank you, Anand.
At my age, you should not even mention it, but thank you so much. Many cultures outlaw it after 45.
It's a very important concept. I almost share that with you, so.
Sorry?
I almost share that age, so.
What are you saying? You look so much younger than me. Oh, Manil, I thought you were my son. I was like, Mikhail, what are you doing? Are you flying a plane? But I just want to mention I'm not a potato or a Punjabi samosa. Just looking at myself here, I'm captivated by how much fat I've got thanks to lockdown around the cheeks, which were ample in any case. But I'm sure you have more interesting things and more...
Absolutely. And we'll talk about the lockdown also as we go along. Just before we start this conversation, Cyrus, for the audience, just to remind you all, there is a question tab down there. Please have your questions coming in so that whenever I have time, I will have them put on to Cyrus for his real typical Cyrus Brocha replies. And also, there is a chat box down there. For all the viewers, you can show us a love for Cyrus, HSBC, be generous. And let's get on. So Cyrus, thank you. Thank you for being with us on your birthday. I know it's lockdown, but we are unlocked. So we are getting out, but you still found time to be with us. A big thank you for that.
Anand, honestly, I have a bit of superstition about this whole thing. Whenever I do any work, event, shoot, whatever, on my birthday, it's been a good year. Like last year, there was no work, for example. But the year before, there was. And the 2 years had very different results. Of course, I'm still married, which is another story altogether. I'm talking more from a financial career point of view. So this is a good thing. And may wonderful. I just mention that I have two credit cards which HSBC tags on it. Just pushing them through in case there's a problem and someone can help me at some point.
Absolutely.
After all, we are Indians and we have to do a little setting on the side.
And for my job and the way I look with all this headgear, you would understand what I do for my living. I head the contact center. So it's all in us. So whenever you call me, probably you'll get through to me next time on. Anyway, wow. Carrying on, Cyrus.
Sure, Anand, after we chat, you'll never speak to me again.
We'll wait and watch. I think before we understand more on that, Cyrus, and get to know you better on your birthday. You know, we have been hearing all these versions today of the new normal. And this is what's on for the last 3 months, professionally, on television, media, everywhere. You know, it'll be great for us to know what does the new normal mean to you? In typical Cyrus Brocha style.
Yeah, well, for us now, events which used to be so much fun for us, we'd be playing a room, hundreds of people from HSBC, staff, dealers, whatever, that's gone out of the window. I'm now, my anxiety is not about, you know, am I feeling fit, ready, energy is good, I hope I say the right things. Now my anxiety is, will the tech work? Will the Wi-Fi not hang? Will my voice be heard? Do I look like a potato from this kind of close-up? And so the issues have changed completely. This whole new normal thing for me is a little overdone. I think everything is anyway adapting. The whole world is adapting at such a fast pace before lockdown as well. So I think we're just going into another faster adaptation mode. But it's the way we human beings are. There's no way out of it. So, I've learned a lot about myself, as most people have during lockdown. Because you spend so much time with your, it's tested your marriage, your relationship with your parents, with your kids, with your neighbors. I mean, I understand Big Boss. I actually call lockdown Big Boss for middle class people across India. You know, because we're stuck. And then after some time, the rifts start happening. And I have never cleaned a toilet myself. I did not know that there was a drawer underneath the basin. I didn't even know it existed. And inside there was all these things with blue and green liquids, which looked really good to drink. But apparently you have to use it to clean the toilet bowl. So I must tell you, my life has changed. Literally, you know, when you're cleaning the toilet bowl and looking at your face in the reflection, you realize where your career and life is heading. But hopefully that will change post maybe September, October. Let's see, fingers crossed. Anand, I talk a lot. So please, if you think I'm talking too much, I have a gavel here. You have to bang the gavel on the table. That you like?
You have it, right?
But that's the problem. I'll try and send it via the Wi-Fi.
But he said, this is how life, like the Big Boss house, has been for you. But trust me, many of us today in this conversation associate with that and relate with that. And that's the change for all of us. I think, but this is a Big Boss house in a different way because we can see the Big Boss many a time.
Yeah.
Unlike that.
I don't know about your house. In my house, my wife suddenly became fully in charge of everything. So it was quite painful because we depended on her for almost everything in the first 2 months. And the way power shifted completely. And I just realized that my life is just like a life of a rock star or something, living outside the house for, you have no idea how the house works. It was like an eye opener. Please God, absolutely. Never again. Let me go back. I'll do the worst shows in the worst part of the world, but I don't want to stay at home for 4 months ever again.
So I think great to know that your lockdown period was very similar to many of us. And from that point, maybe I could get back to your younger days and really back in time when you started your career. You started when you were just 12 years old and you did your first film, Jalwa. And Jalwa, you know, for us who were just getting to understand the 80s and getting there, is that poster. Nasiruddin Shah and Nasir and Archana Puran Singh. And that's what was Jalwa for us, being put up everywhere.
You know, also he sort of remodeled himself. You remember Nasir was the king of parallel cinema. And I'm talking to people of our age, Rupa Anand, so if they're youngsters watching, tend to go out to the toilet for 5 minutes because there's no point. These references, it's hilarious how our references make no sense to so many people. Anyway, so Nasir was known as the king of parallel stage and this and that. Acting, he's actor's actor. And then he went and did this film where he, you know, built his physique and was doing Maramari and, you know, Bollywood, in many ways, a real hardcore Bollywood sort of film. So it was a great thing to be around a guy like that who was trying to reinvent himself. By the way, he hated it. He went back to artistic films after that in a hurry. And he's really done. He did a few here and there. But by and large, I think this was his big one.
Absolutely. I think, and for you, as a 12-year-old, how was it interacting with such big names? Pankaj Kapoor there, Pankaj Parashar, the director, Nasiruddin Shah himself, and many others.
Yeah, well, the boys, I was about 13 actually. The boys in school used to tease me after the film came out about the fact that I have a whole thing where I'm like a drug addict and I run away from the home, the shelter where I'm being treated. And I come, and my sister Archana is very upset. And then she comes and meets me and finds out that, you know, I actually come to the house and she's like really upset with me for running away from the home and causing all that anxiety. And she slaps me. And then actually the beautiful moment, poignant moment where I have a Rakhi in my hand and I say, aapko yaad nahi aaj Rakhi hai, and I open the hand and the Rakhi is there and the violins play in the background. And then she hugs me. And of course, I was like a 13-year-old boy, adolescent boy. And she was this, you know, hot, you know, I suppose in the 20s, I can't remember now, hot, you know, very beautiful, very glamorous film star. And so all the boys said, how many takes for the hug? How many takes? Same bloody joke I had to listen to for the next, like, I think 12 to 15 months. Hey, kitna take liya? Oh, God, it was hilarious.
But trust me, in the 80s, even that was a task, right? So.
No, I think men don't change. They're the same stupid, you know, like my name is Cyrus. You know, how many people have come up to me and said Cyrus the Virus? And they think it's their original gag. You know, you're not allowed to shoot people. We're not a fascist state in that sense. So I can't take out a gun and shoot. There are so many redundant moments in your life. But the guy who says it, like the guy who said, how many takes to hug Archana? You know, they all think they've come up with this brilliant plan that all the naughty, creepy teenagers are thinking the same thing. But God, it was very painful. So I've sat through all this. But they were great. Archana, they were lovely. I didn't know that Nasir was so well-read. I knew nothing about him. I thought he was a typical, you know, hate to give stereotypes, but I'm a South Bombay boy from, you know, lawyer background. And so, you know, we sort of looked down on, you know, I don't think my parents looked down, but you grew up thinking you'd join HSBC or start a business or a startup or whatever and not really get into this kind of business. So I didn't think they were very educated, to be honest. It sounds like racism, but it's true. But they were all superbly, they were all intellectuals. It was a great group. And Nasir is really well-read and he can talk about any topic. From boxing to NASA. I mean, we discussed everything.
Wonderful.
But he would flip. His switch would happen and he never shouted at me. I was this young boy sitting in the background quietly. But suddenly he'd be talking to me and telling me, Chekhov is a fascinating writer. You have to, he just screams at someone on set and everybody gets scared. And then he comes back. So I'm saying Chekhov in the same tone. He just switches. But it was an experience. Really.
So I think films at 13, a first film at 13, and then within a year, you did your first professional play, Brighton Beach Memoirs for
Pearl Padmasree.
Oh, you did the play first, okay.
I did the play first, yeah.
Our research went wrong.
They came and saw the play. See, they all from the, okay. the artistic background. Pankaj, Nasir, and Gulanand, the producer, of course. He was the main guy. Three of them came to see the play. And I was quite... I had no idea about Hindi films. When they said, come, 3 weekends in Goa. It sounds quite creepy now when I think about it. Yeah, but it was great.
They got you the movie.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Oh, wonderful.
It was, yeah.
So how was your shift between theater to cinema?
So different mediums. I'm sure you've heard this before. They make you work for about 6 weeks, 7 weeks on a play, generally. And you learn your lines and do positions and this and that. And you work quite hard in terms of rehearsal. Coming from me, that's something that I hate working. In films, you basically just learn a couple of lines and do maybe one rehearsal and then you shoot it. So it's actually like a really easy version of a play in that sense. But the only thing is that you've got to spend the whole day waiting to shoot. My advice to anybody who doesn't like working, become an actor. Because there are many days when you'll do just one line, or you'll do just one scene where you're in the background, or you'll do one song where you have like half a verse. So there are many days when you don't have too much to do. You'll sit in a nice trailer, you'll be treated like a god. They'll only ask you about breakfast 3 times, lunch 4 times, dinner 7 times. You can now, thanks to the internet, you can do all kinds of things, play with whatever, you know, the thing that you're on, whatever games that you like. So you can interact with whoever you want to. And you have 5 minutes of work. They'll come and say, shot ready here. They put your clothes on for you. You walk in, you do 2 takes, 3 takes. People get bored of you in 3 takes and send you back. So acting is very good if you don't want to work. I really believe that.
And if you don't rarely, work. Sorry? And you're able to complete, if you don't want to work, or you have to come, you are able to complete that in 1 or 2 takes, then it's a 5 minute job. Varna to din nikal jayega.
I think some actors, because they feel so bad about the art, they actually take more than one take. Because, okay, let me tell you a really bad story. I was called after the play also for a audio recording, for a jingle. And it was, I don't know if you remember, Iodex, Ooh Ah Ouch. Again, this is from the 80s,
absolutely,
early 90s.
Yes,
somewhere
yes.
There. You remember it?
Ooh, yes, back pakad ke, yes.
So me, Mohan Kapoor, who did Saap Seeni, also was an actor for some time, and he was in advertising and theatre as well. And there was a third gentleman who I forget. We each had one word. I had who, Mohan had ah, and the third guy had ouch. And I stood there, and there were all these advertising guys in their strange, you know, avatars of kurta and jeans, and you know, the usual stereotypes. And I'm going, ooh. So the guy looks at me and says, Baruja, ab ek kaam karo, wo mein wo emphasis nahi hoti hai usme. You must get it from internalize it more. So it's ooh. Haan, ooh karo. Then he turns to the second guy, right? He says, what do you think? That guy says, it's more ooh. Haan, more ooh, haan, more ooh. So ooh karo. So I did ooh about 11 times. Anand, I swear to my mother, I this is real comedy. I couldn't believe. So I finished it. They gave me 10,000 rupees in a check for saying ooh 11 times.
Wow.
I said, ooh, 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 like an idiot. I mean, sometimes it's amazing. The business is just amazing, really. I came back home and my poor father, who works long hours, he's did LLB, solicitors, honors and all. He looked at this check and said, what? This is 88, 89. So 10 grand was a lot of money. He was like, why? What have you done? Are you with some drug gang or something? What is this? And how can I explain to him? I just said, ooh. And I felt bad. I wanted to go back and do more, at least 10 more oohs, so that the money became slightly more justified. How can you get paid to say, ooh?
Oh, did you get a similar ad later?
I never got such a short one. But then you learn the business. You just have to do a little acting. So the advertising community also feels happy. Everyone has to feel good that they've done something. So it's more like an act. So you know, we have guys who do voiceovers with their hands like this. And just to say one line, like, it's India, the magnificent.
So the intensity.
The intensity. And everyone's happy because of the body language. So you pick up all that. So it's fun. But in the beginning, you judge all this. After some time, you're okay with it. And, you know, it's just go jaisa and you sort of enjoy yourself better. Yeah.
Exciting anyways. You know, after all this, then the big thing was you were the face of MTV. Apart from the ladies there, of course, but you were the face from this sort of agenda. So I think, and there I remember you had those great opportunities to interview some big names. Shah Rukh Khan, Amitabh Bachchan, and our research, I don't know if it is wrong here again, like earlier, Amitabh Bachchan had something to say to you after one of those interviews. If you recollect that, would you want to share that?
Oh, that involves some, are you talking about the bad language, where the phone went off?
I think yes, yes.
Okay, but I don't think I can use the Punjabi language here. So what? I'll set it up without using any bad language. It's just because, again, it's very surreal. You can't imagine this is happening to you. Now, keep in mind, I'm a South Bombay boy who grew up in the 80s and 90s. So, Amitabh Bachchan was the only actor I watched. And a lot of us were the same. I mean, with due respect to all of them, from Dharmendra downwards, Amitabh Bachchan was the only guy. You know, it was Kalia's release, off we go. Namakalal, off we go. Mr. Dural, you ask me any Amitabh Bachchan film, I'm in. But you ask me any other film, I have no idea. Really struggling. So he was. It was the first time that I was a little worried. Rahul Khanna was supposed to do it, Vinod Khanna's son, and he then disappeared last minute or whatever, so they put it on to me. So then we the mobile phones had just started, you know, at that point, somewhere in the late 90s, mid-90s. And he sat down. He was very friendly, actually. He was okay. There's no problem. But he sits on 5-6 chairs because of his long legs, which are put together, which is intimidating. And we started talking. And then Vasar Valsan, who subsequently did Bakra with me, who is my Malayali friend, born and bred in Delhi, who speaks Hindi better than Malayalam. This is a great story on its own. So Vasant and I, we were chatting with the crew and told everybody that Mr. Bachchan is known to sometimes be a little moody. We do not want him to get upset. We want him happy. No phone, no sound when the interview is going on. Just let it go and we'll get some good stuff and then you can, you know, do what you want. So we start the interview. And I say, Mr. Bachchan, picture ke baare mein kuch bata, whatever the usual generic questions. And the most famous voice in India goes, "Oh, to dekhe, ye hai, wo hai, ye karta, wo karta, usme ye plot hai, ye twist hai, ye done." And he starts talking. And you won't believe it. The bloody phone goes off in that tight, small studio in the audio. Ting, ting, ting. I nearly died. I was like, who? And Vasant lost it. Born and bred in Delhi, couldn't stop the language, just screamed on the PA, "Kaun hai? Kiska phone chalo hai? Kaun hai wo?" And you can use the phrase.
The Delhi words. The Delhi words.
Delhi words. The two of them, the elder female lady mentioned person thing. And then we froze because he used that on the PA. So, and suddenly, there was silence for about 3 seconds. And then the most famous voice of India goes, "Wo, dash, 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 main ho." And he takes up the phone and shuts it. Anand,
trust me, if you could use those words now, it would have been really funny, but I understand.
I don't know what kind of forum I've done in my stand-up all the time because it's so scary. I couldn't make eye contact with him because I couldn't call whether it's, you know, this British humor, you know, laid-back sort of whatever. But he was angry because you disrespected him with this kind of language in front of him. And when he left, Vasant and I, you know, I think we had aged 5 years. But I tell you, he was just being facetious. He was just being funny. He's got a great sense of humor. And he's got superb timing. And he's Amitabh Bachchan. I mean, think of comedy. That's like, he hit it out of the park. Everyone, we wanted to laugh, but we dare not. We all just stood there. And nobody could look at him. It was fabulous. Yeah. Subsequently, I have another lovely story.
Yeah.
2000, which is the millennial year. I was coming back from Delhi because, you know, we get these events to do and they pay you 5 times on the New Year, so you have to do it. And nothing like a Delhi party because there's nothing to do. Everybody's having a good time, inebriated, screaming and shouting. So after 5 minutes of introductions, I also am drinking and having a good time on the side. So catch the early morning flight to come back because I like coming home for whatever reason. And the 6 o'clock morning flight, I'm sitting there quietly. And then this great personality walks in. So I didn't want to disturb him on that 6 o'clock morning flight and all and say, "Sir, do you remember me? We chatted all." I just keep a low profile. And he sat wherever he sat. He also doesn't, you know, he doesn't look for attention. He never makes eye contact when he's walking, if you see him anywhere. He's always looking down or looking sideways. So I left him. I thought, Canelo, he's the great Amitabh Bachchan. Now let me not push it. You know, I can't start calling him by first name. We go on to the bus, that bus that takes you, connecting bus from the, when you land in Bombay. And on the bus, my bad luck, Anand, there's only him and me on that first bus. When they put us in business for whatever reason, there was nobody at 6 o'clock in the morning. So I sit there with my head down and I try not to look at the gate because he comes slowly and all that. And some two bodyguards come to make sure he gets on and all. He gets on. And then he looks at me and I'm trying not to make eye contact. He says, "Mr. Brocha, bol gaya." He didn't know what to say. I said, "No, sir, I didn't want to disturb you." But he was really gracious. He's good, yeah. Some of these guys like Shah Rukh and him, it's a little arrogant to say, but I'm sure if we grew up together, we'd have gotten along really well. Shah Rukh talks as much as me. He doesn't want to stop talking. He has an opinion on anything. He's always fun. You just have to start the camera. And see, the kind of guy you do an interview with, there's never a fear. The fear is that he won't stop. It'll never be the other way around. So it's great for us to have him at an event. And Amitabh is, nobody knows how funny he is. He is just so bloody funny. When I get to talk to him while doing interviews off camera and all the things he would say, I mean, oh God, I asked him, "What is your biggest role as a young man?" And he just looked at me deadpan and said, "I had to play a chicken." I've seen every Amitabh Bachchan film. I said, "There's one song with references to chicken and this tangri kebab." And this. He said, "No, when I was in college, when I was in school, I had to play the role of a chicken, a murgi." and with a straight face. Now, again, you can't start laughing because you don't know whether he's actually saying it's challenging or whether he's being facetious. But he's fabulous. I have great memories of all that. Really good. Good stuff.
Wonderful, wonderful. I think any memory with a legend like Amitabh is going to be something to cherish with. From there on MTV, the legendary show and the event Bakra. I think that word really went across the country with the meaning that we know today, I think, only after the show. Well, maybe it was the same way in Mumbai before that, but now the whole country knows what Bakra is.
Honestly, we had no idea this Bakra would do so well, you know. The whole idea was, I think it was Manisha Koirala had come for an interview, and there are guys who smoke cigarettes in our small unit. I don't. But to smoke, they would go down. So this is at CNM, it was called, at Worli, next to Glaxo. Mm-hmm. So we went down and just give them company. The boys are smoking, whatever, and the other, we just give them company and stand around. So I was showing, you know, in college, I don't know if you guys did it, but as juveniles, we used to do this stuff where we'd stop taxis for no reason. The taxi would pass and it would go, taxi! And he'd break and he'd say, time kya hai? You know, stupid things like that. So I was showing the, most of the boys are from Delhi, Chennai, Bangalore and all that. So I was trying to explain to them, this is the rubbish that we do in college. And somebody shot it. One of the boys, because they bring the cameras down. They can't leave them alone, unattended. So they shot it. So we finished the thing. We went home. And the editors who were editing the Manisha Koirala interview and found it a little boring. At the end, they saw this stupid stopping taxi drivers and saying, Andheri jayega, bachao. You know, that rubbish. And they laughed and laughed. And they're showing it to each other. So then my boss, Natasha, the executive producer, she looked at it and said, this is something interesting. Everybody likes it. So we actually were only targeting cabs in the beginning. It wasn't called Bakra. We were just shooting a show where we target cabs and do masti. You know, this is now a little bit of urban angst. You know, the young Indian male in Bombay, Delhi, Chennai, Mumbai fighting the taxi driver and the rickshaw driver. We have our own personal little politics going on. And that's at an age when you're, you know, out of school and before you get a job. So it was that first. Then we realized that it was, people just liked it, and it went, you know, it didn't have a language issue, it didn't have a class issue, everybody seemed to watch it. Balasaheb Thackeray called my house, because it used to air 3:30. So the phone call came, and I picked up the phone, and it was like, hello, and he called himself. There was nobody, no thing. Yeah, he spoke in English very clearly. Now, I normally, Anand, this is another bloody, this is a reverse Bakra show happened. I have a pal called Sam, who's really badly behaved like me. And he's famous. We always, even today, we call up with accents and, you know, hello, this is Donald Trump speaking. This you and I, infantile crap like that. So for a second, I was going to say, Sam, I'll smack you. You know, something rude or MCBC would have come out. But then just something told me, just in case, don't say anything bad. So I said, yes, sir, thank you and all that. And he said he stops the meeting at 3:30 to see the show. And he put the phone down. That's it. And my aunt is a journalist. So he got the number from her and all that. It's a long story. But I found out it was really him. I checked with all the boys if you got anyone to call me. Because he spoke very normally, and then which is a normal way, no emotions or anything. He said, hello, is that Cyrus? Just wanted to tell you we like your program. I stopped the meetings. First he said, Balasaheb Thackeray. He introduced himself like that. And in English, not in Marathi. Spoke in English. And so I was, you know, so these kind of things happen. And then slowly I realized that this damn show must be bigger than I think. My dhobi, the guy started telling me. I mean, I've been on TV for about 4 or 5 years, and now he starts telling me, "Oh, asli hai ya nakli hai?" So when that guy started watching it, and then every week he would come and discuss to me what went wrong with the gag in his eyes. So you know, these little.
And imagine that was not the time when you had mobiles with every individual who could just watch it was still so popular.
Come out, but very
absolutely.
Few years. Yeah.
I think wonderful. Okay, one more question before we take some audience questions now. I think a lot have come in here. I've been getting some hints here.
Already been highlighted.
Yeah, probably. But before that, I think when I talk of the Bakra show, I think the next logical flow should be the week that wasn't. And really, that's how it defines Cyrus in the present day, which is now on for 12 years, I understand. So it is larger than any sitcom at this point in time.
If they don't sack us by October, it'll be 14.
Yeah, and this is one which is, I can see it through almost in the second half of the lockdown, you've been there on the show. So we've been seeing it through, right?
We've gone to the studio because the news channels are open from March 22nd. So instead of 2 days a week, we work one because they put policies in place. But I have got every week. And,
absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, but how did this come about? How did this start 14 years ago?
See, this is Rajdeep Sardesai's, you have to give him, this is completely his idea. He wanted a John Stewart. I don't know if you've seen these political satire shows in America. So he wanted a John Stewart-like thing, which would give a little spin to his network. It was called CNN IDN then, and he was the editor. So he called me for a meeting and said, I want to do a show which is political satire and spoofs. What do you think? I was so happy, Anand. I mean, all I do at MTV is make sounds. You know, I mean, playing through Patra and, you know, putting caps on people and bullying them. Here we get to write and think and, you know, have a normal conversation and yet try and spin something funny. So it was like my parents could be proud. They could now go to a party and say, they can show this. How do you show me dressed in diapers on an MTV promo? And all, you know, that was a little difficult for them. So I got to hand it to Rajdeep. He's a very forward thinking. I know the other guy has got more eyeballs now, his colleague. Who's investigative reporter number one, and judge, jury, and executioner. But, and of course, he's got his own style. But Rajdeep has actually not been given his due. He's a fantastic reporter, and he had all these ideas, which I think, you know, when you have a hardcore news channel and you have one show which is a little silly and edgy, it's a good balance to have.
Yeah.
And that was his idea. But then, you know, now he's not there, so we'll see how that goes.
But I think that show really is wonderful, and I think catches all of us. To really feel that away in the week.
Anand, we learn from Bakra. Just keep apologizing before. It's like a disclaimer. Because in Bakra also, I used to tell the boys, because sometimes these guys get violent. And, you know, one of my boys once got out and said, raised his hand and we had to pull him off and all. You know, you have to understand, we are doing something wrong. We are destroying somebody's life and confidence for a few seconds. So you can't get aggressive. So if someone's aggressive, all we can do is say sorry, back off until they calm down. Which, of course, we did. That taught us well for a week, that wasn't. But having said that, we have met many of the political bigwigs who've actually said nice things to us, like Chidambaram. Yeah. Prakash Javadekar actually mentioned us in the beginning of the year when he was talking about, I think Rahul Gandhi had said something, and he said, it's okay if Cyrus Bocha makes these comments on his comedy show, but this is the leader of opposition. So in that context, you know, and so I've met many of them, and they've said nice things. So far, so good. I mean, try not to get personal.
Fabulous.
Yeah.
Okay. That note, that gets us to some audience questions. And I think this has come from our discussion on Amitabh and Bollywood. So this is from Danish Khan. Hi, Cyrus.
Hi, Danish.
Actors in Bollywood have started doing comedy, which was earlier done by specialist comedians as sidekicks, probably. But that was really appreciated by audience. Do you think the present mode of the main actors doing this delivers humor and justifies?
It's a little complicated question, but I think in the old days, 80s and 90s, at least, they had a comedy track. Like Johnny Lever it was in your MOU. You had to put him in. First wrote your script, you then got your hero, you started shooting, and then you figured Johnny would come, and then Johnny, abhi kya karne ka? Acha, wo karo phir. And then he'll do something, and we'll put it in the track, whatever happens. That item number had the same. That world has changed now. I think it's if you look at Netflix and all these things that are available, movies have come a long way. You can't compare them. And I think if an actor has to survive, he has to be able to do everything. None of them are going to really survive playing just one stereotype. There's only one great actor who's been able to manage that. He's played Salman in every film, and he's still the like superstar. But other than him, I can't think of anybody else. These young guys, they're all you know, very good at everything. If you noticed. And what's amazing, I put down this whole acting profession in the beginning. I should apologize. Dancing is tough. You've got to understand, if any of you guys give up banking, and I'm sure you're fine actors and all, because I've interviewed people and realized they're in the wrong profession. Middle class India tells you, banker banao, banjao, engineer banjao, lawyer banjao, business, whatever. So sometimes you lose a lot of talent. But dancing is a whole different ballgame. And what people don't realize, when they actually shoot the dancing, they shoot one line at a time. There is a show called Jhalak Dikhla Ja. And I thought it would be a joke, you know. But then when you, I remember Pyar Ka Signal, Remo song was the first thing that we danced to. Just that first line, I had to hear it 45, Pyar Ka Signal, Pyar Ka Signal. And cut, do that dance. So the first line 20 times, then the second line 20 times, then both the lines together 20 times. It's not fun. It's so painful. It's worse than algebra. Oh, absolutely. God.
Oh, we didn't know that this happens in the shows also. This has been a revelation to me.
Oh, they are very, the TV actors are far more ambitious. I think they would work all night after shooting all day. You know, they would keep telling me, why are you so lazy? Rohit Roy, what do you do after 12 hours of shift? Then, for 6 hours for dancing practice, uske baad puchta hai ki subah bhi kar lo. I said, there's no subah left, do the max. 24 minus 18, he's left for 3-4 hours. And he still wants to come back. So, they set very high standards in terms of ambition and working hard, spoiling the name of actors. Here, I thought it was the easiest thing in the world. But dancing, God, no. That's not easy.
Maybe there's one more again, Cyrus, on Bollywood and cinema from Arunabrata Ray. Hi, Cyrus. Probably this is an often asked question. Do you have any preferred roles that you want to play as an actor, on screen or otherwise? So I don't know what he means by that, but I'll leave it.
It's not that you see shows and you say, oh, wow, I would wish I was in the show. So like The Office, which they made in Hindi as well. I love Ricky Gervais, British comedian. So those kind of shows or Monty Python series from the old days where I love Blackadder, those kind of shows I would love to do. In Hindi, the flop show is something which I think has again not been given enough credit. Jaspal Bhatti, I don't know if you, again, what Absolutely, age. Yeah. These references are wrong. All my references are wrong now for many people working in, even in HSBC.
But Jaspal Bhatti, I think, is a legend. I think legend. People will remember that. Absolutely.
I mean, Anand, the guy was a genius. I mean, they should name roads after him. I want to in Bombay, I want to go and pull out roads sometimes and say, who is this guy? He's just some name on some joke. Put it on to people who you really respect. The guy was fantastic. Absolutely. What a mind. Superb. I mean, really. And well ahead of his time. And his style. We talked about Amitabh Bachchan's comedy. His style, his deadpan style, was just fabulous.
Exactly.
Once you got into Flop Show, I think that first season of Flop Show is as good as any international comedy ever in the history of the world. It's just, do you remember the one where he's a he decides to be a professional chief guest? As a job.
I don't really. Okay.
Oh, you must see that. It's hilarious. So he comes on time to be the professional chief guest, and they scream at him. How can a chief guest come on time? You know, I mean, it's just, think of the thinking is fabulous. You know, like, which angle did chief guest come here? Time came. So they give him a hammer and a nail and tell him to help with the set. Hey, unbelievable. A lot of respect. Great, great.
Man. I think.
I wish. Really, we should honor these guys. They're the real heroes.
Absolutely. I completely agree with you. I think on that ground, there's something on comedy also from Ali Asghar. Hi, Cyrus.
Ali Asghar, how do the you?
Oh, I hope name. So. Obviously, it's the same name. Or if it is the Ali Asghar, the actor, he will let us know on the next question. Yeah. Because he can be here on the show. Why not?
He's an HSBC card holder.
Maybe. Huh? But this is open for public too. And he may be a customer. Why not? So the question, by the way, is, hi, Cyrus. How do you define today's comedy, comedy elements as compared to yesteryear's?
I think now we've got, it's like cricket. Cricket has got T20. You've got T10 coming up. You've got 50 overs. You've got 40 overs in England. If you want, in county cricket, you've got test matches. And now they're looking at four-day test matches, night test matches. Everything is shifted into different styles. So I think comedy is also like that. You've got English stand-up comedy. You've got stand-up comedy in Indian languages, which is also vibrant and, you know, growing really fast, actually. Absolutely. Which is different on the internet. Then you've got sitcoms, which will never go out of fashion. They're still there. And you've got reality shows, which are comedy from our point of view. Then you have the ultimate comedy, which is Arnab's 9 o'clock show, which doesn't position itself as a comedy, but it's funny. So there's all kinds of comedy out there. So I think...
So what do you think? Jo bikta hai, wo banta hai? Ya jo banta hai, wo bikta hai?
Oh, this is a very tough question. It's like chicken and egg. How to answer that? Anand, let's put it out as an audience poll and let them come up with it.
Maybe, guys, what is made gets watched, or what is wanted to be watched gets made. Let's have your opinions. Use the same question box for your answers. And at that note, Cyrus, let's move to something very different. We call this down the memory lane.
Right.
And here we have some of your old photographs.
Everybody
from our archives.
So I remember everything.
Absolutely. If you have one, then send me one.
I apologize because the team at HSBC and the event guys wanted me to provide them with many more photographs. But unfortunately, I'm not a guy who collects anything except grudges and those kind of things. So I looked around and I wasn't able to provide enough. So whatever you have.
So they would have done their research somewhere on the net and otherwise and got this out. So may I request...
From adult erotic sites, they have taken pictures that I have performed in. And these are there.
If they are going to be put up on the HSBC show, you could be sure from where they can.
Oh boy. Yeah, this is a kasai who's eating his own food. So this is a Bakra promo that we shot in 2009 or 10. Oh. It was the last season that we did. So we wanted to shoot it. We went to Baikala and we shot it. We got a proper, you know, I think there were goats and all there in the background in the final promo. And if I remember correctly, we shot at 4 in the morning. So I had to report at 3 in the morning for this. It was very painful. Amazingly, that in spite of Bakra and all that, and it's being a little morbid and, you know, the whole idea of, as you can see, thing in his hand and all that. Nobody ever thought of using the butcher Kasai reference with Bakra till then, and we've been on air for 11 years.
It's absolutely amazing. Nobody has again used it in the same way.
But very painful. It looks like I'm having fun, but very painful. Kajal in the eyes. The locket didn't come off, I remember, after it was put on. They couldn't take it off.
It looks very tight anyways, yeah.
Yeah. So is the blouse. As you can see, I look like a young Rakhi Sawant. So But the thing is, standard is I get up at 2:33, reach there at 3:15 or something, and then you know, we shot between 4 and 6 with this strange light before daylight hits.
Oh,
prepare me for life as a top security watchman, if nothing else works, because I can do the night shift now peacefully, wearing that out.
Wonderful, wonderful. We have many more. I think if you could get to the next one, please.
This is this is good fun. We shot. I play a photographer. And when you, I don't know if you guys have taken a passport photo recently, but even the passport photo guy in that small parda, you know, that he provides and all, is a failed artist. Like if he gets a chance, he'll be like, "Or smile, kar gaya." Nein, aisa nahi, aisa nahi. Aisa karo, aisa. Thoda emotion. They actually talk to you like that because they've got nothing else. This is their art. So we had great fun because once you have a person in front of a camera, you can really, really sort of bully them because most people get a little intimidated. So this worked very well for us. And okay. Yeah, it was great fun. That's Asif on the right, who's our makeup man. I don't know where. Asif Chaus. Great, great guy.
Wonderful. Can we have the next one, please?
So we did a lot of... Okay, so now let me tell you a background story. In 2011, towards the end of Bakra, a Japanese channel bought Bakra. They bought a season or two seasons or whatever. And the guy came down and interviewed me through an interpreter about what the gags were. And you know, the thing that fascinated me the most was not the creativity or lack of it. It was the fact that we could dress up as policemen and walk around. Nobody stopped you. In Japan, there's no way that you could impersonate a police officer and just walk around. But you know, I think we shot this in Oshiwara, if I remember correctly. And I went for lunch. This girl, the crew of four of us, there are four, maybe six actors actually dressed as cops. We didn't even change. We went to Fountain Inn in Andheri or Oshiwara.
Yeah.
And we sat there as cops. It was great fun. And you can see the body language of those serving us and all. They come very quickly. They bought the whole thing. But we couldn't. There was no place for... We didn't have a vanity van. There was no place to change before we take a break. We just went as cops. And then suddenly we're like, cops speaking in broken Hindi and English and all that. And mix of languages and everything. Which anybody would have picked up. They were fake cops after some time. But they wouldn't call our bluff. We just sat and ate. That gave me a lot of confidence to go back, you know. Because once you sit in that character for a long time, you start actually believing your myth. And then you start, swagger with the sunglasses. But I tell you, the moment you wear a uniform, a lot of people back off from you. You're like a Rottweiler. Suddenly they're a little worried. I hate to say that, but it gives you a little bit of a power thrill. Please don't impersonate police officers. That's something wrong. IPC has a code against it. I'll Google it and tell you which number as well. But yeah, this was unbelievable.
Uniform, you maintain social distancing automatically.
Anand, it's hilarious. We didn't have permissions on the road, nothing. I don't know how we would just, talk to the van and they stopped and asked us and all that. That's it. And mostly they would allow us to shoot. Or we'd have to, the old-fashioned Indian setting would happen on the side, which I can't mention on a public platform. But having said that, today there is no way we could get away with this.
You can do that.
Not with the kind of security we have. I was just wandering around. The four of us just wandering around waiting. We have an area where we're performing the Bakra and we just wait there in our uniforms. Nobody would call our bluff.
Absolutely.
Man. God.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Do we have the next one?
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Oh, this is... I've written actually four books. And yes. I think I've sold three copies of each. This is from the Hindustan Times columns that I write. And a few extra stuff that I've written around it. I've done this in my bad stand-up acts. And, Indian men, they drive me mad when it comes to socializing and trying to patau women. I mean, the kind of things that we used... We had a show called Love Line. Okay? And the things we used to hear... I mean, the guy would say, "Hi, myself, Rakesh. I live in Ludhiana. I like this girl. She's good, but she likes me, but she's not met me." I said, "What? Do you talk on the phone?" "No, no, she doesn't know who I am." "Then how do you know she likes me?" "I'm sure." So, the kind of conversation we'd have. So, and
50% hai meri taraf se.
The beautiful confidence that we have, which is fake, of course. And then how to... There's a guy who used to send me corresponding mail after that 2-3 times, saying that he would go and stand at the bus stop next to this girl that he likes. Okay? And that he kept on doing that. And then she finally called the police. "What should I do?" I figured that he didn't belong to that area. He would just come and stand at the bus stop next to her and look at her. So I said, let me write a book to help people or help our males understand that there's certain things you just can't do. There's no point. Having failed myself with women, I sort of put together all my failures and said, let me see if I can help. I don't think I've made much of a dent, sadly.
Wonderful. Okay, just a reminder for everyone, we will take a few more questions after some time. So please have your questions flowing in. At that point, may I get to the next section of questions that I had already. So Cyrus, India mein do cheeze bikti hai, cricket and Bollywood. And you have been part of both of them in some form or the other. And then your own genre of entertainment. Which has been cricket or Bollywood? Which has been more enjoyable to you as an entertainer?
Cricket, 100%. How can you? Nothing compares with cricket. I cried during lockdown. When live sport went off the air, I cried. We were in the middle of a Legends tournament, in fact, which I was doing on commentary with Mr. Gavaskar and Sanjay Manjrekar. And then, you know, I was so upset, as many people were, that there was no live sport, first time in our life for 4 months. I've got through everything through live sport and through cricket, and Indian cricket especially. So it was very painful for me. So if you're asking me which one is, there's no question, nothing compares with cricket. Cricket first, absolutely. Then family. Family, wow. Country equal, cricket first, family country equal, and then everything else. God, wow. Oof, no question. But listen, Bollywood is also great. Like I said, they spoil you when you act, whatever. I've done 7 or 8 films, and the experience of, for me, lunch is always, because you know, you come on the set and you have to focus on the real things. Once you, with experience, I remember working with Rahul Bose on a film which didn't release, thank God. But we sat for 5 minutes and he said, don't worry about all this, let's focus on lunch. And he was absolutely right. So from the beginning, we wanted, you know, because the scene, I mean, you've got 4 hours to do one scene and all, there's no point. There's no point overworking. So it's all priority, prioritize.
With this, I can clearly see you're a cricket buff, because that cricket is right up here.
It is.
And trust me, yeah. Me too. So yeah, on that point, let's...
You don't know, but I've got the Pakistan-England game going on in the background. And every time I quietly take a look to see how many are down, because not to...
Yeah, they didn't start... England didn't start well that way.
If somebody told that idiot Jason Holder, the West Indies captain, to bat first, they would have had a much better series. But Pakistan, absolutely, learned from that mistake. They're batting first, May 326. It's game on. Anyway,
absolutely.
Sorry to digress.
So maybe I'm taking a cue from the similar game, the same game that's on behind you, or the game that was played between West Indies and England a little earlier.
Yeah.
In this new age of cricket, where you're going to have no empty stadiums, no audience, Test cricket is still better with white, because you're talking the right things. You're looking at this straight bat and looking at that slow-paced cricket. It's more artistic cinema from that point. But do you think how it will sound in a T20 league match later on, or any such fast-paced
cricket? Don't be negative. You're all being too negative. The vaccine is supposed to come out on the 15th. I'm in touch with everybody here. If that doesn't happen, it'll come out sooner or later. No? So this is a temporary phase. Now, we have play in the empty stadiums. American sport is doing it. I mean, we'll get through this season, hopefully. By the time India goes to Australia in December, I'm hoping they'll allow some spectators. IPL is saying 50% will be allowed if that happens in the first place. So I'm saying, don't be negative. Things will change. It's a temporary period.
So is there
vaccine? Tell the HSBC employees to work on their vaccine. Leave the banking sector. Work on the vaccine. There are labs all across the city. Whoever gets the vaccine never has to work again for 3 generations. 194 countries will be buying it. So don't worry.
Cyrus, we have enough work on our finances with our customers. Oh, enough. Yeah. And let's work on that. Boys, we'll keep that in state. Yeah. Vaccines will come in, and people working on that. But anyway, I'm saying, if there are empty stadiums, and if that is going to be, and the vaccine is delayed hypothetically, do you think that void that is created by the loss of energy of spectators not being there, could it be filled with some other genre like what you provide? And maybe the style of commentary will completely change. Just thinking aloud. Yeah, so, maybe another caption in your introduction that I have.
I'll take it on advisement. I'll give you 50% of equity if this goes through. But I have to tell you, all said and done, I think the home sides, and even American sport, I've watched some basketball. And because their home support is for adrenaline and for, you know, there's a certain blood rush which helps a sportsman at some point in the game. So that's really sad that that's not there. I mean, your bowlers, imagine if Mohammad Shami is turning to bowl and Wankhede Stadium is empty, you know, but normally it'll be like screaming as he comes into bowl, or Virat Kohli's, you know, 99 batting. I mean, you won't hear. So many visiting captains come here and say, we can't tell our fielders anything, because they can't hear us from first slip, can't hear second slip. The Indian crowds are unbelievable when we're at it. So, yeah, what to do? I want us to end this lockdown. Everyone should pretend there is no lockdown now. I just can't take it anymore. And let the crowds come back. Can't wait.
Absolutely, I think we're slowly getting there, but hope that vaccine helps us to get there. At least the hope of that vaccine helps us to get there earlier. Because I think once we know that it's coming, we'll start that.
I hope people know where to put the vaccine. You know how some of our people like to experiment, really.
I'm just the trained experts will do that for us. But I think, yeah, I'll ask one more question and then we'll go to a few more audience questions because I've hinted that a few are coming around. So you just spoke about your book. You spoke about various aspects of your life and career that you've done. Also, as a podcaster, you started hosting a podcast called Cyrus Says. And I think, did it change its name later? And what was the show all about?
We have one is called Cock and Bull, which is my favorite name, which Wikipedia apparently doesn't use the word because they find it's a word you can't use. But it's just a hen, a male hen. And the other one is a bull, which was from the bovine family, where we are all safe in India. Can't touch that. So that show came out when the guest cancelled. So all these accidents are actually great, you know, like how we got Bakra. So the guest cancelled, so we couldn't do a thing. So I got two of the boys and we started just talking about the week and fighting and arguing over issues. And then we thought we had a great time doing that. So we kept that as an option. And now that show actually does even better, in our limited podcast space. So yeah, so we have a guest one, which is called Cyrus Says, and then we have that, which is where I can have you on and on and we can just keep chatting just exactly like this. But exactly, a little more aggressive. Yeah.
Wonderful. Okay, coming to audience questions now that we are running out of time. Cyrus, yeah, I'll just read this out from Mayank Rana. Hi, Cyrus. We would love to see you collaborating with Joe Cavasco for his take on misheard Jose. Lyrics. Oh. Yeah. Sorry.
So Jose is my MTV colleague, actually, for a couple of years. Towards the end of my long reign of 14 or 15 years at MTV, Jose was there. And then he was the first guy to get into this whole internet space and started spinning out his videos and all that. And now he has some 40 million followers and he's banned in China and Japan and places like that. But he's doing really well. The thing is, when I got onto social media last year for the first time as a 70-year-old, I tried to get in touch with Jose, but it's damn tough to reach him. He doesn't exist. He's like a ghost. He's almost like a spy. I wonder if he's actually from a country because no one can find him. But he's made a great name for himself in that world and he's put out some great content. So I'll try. If he takes the phone, I'll happily work with him. We have worked on MTV together quite a bit.
Okay.
I would say he's as lazy as I am, which is always a great fact. When I work with someone, I first have to know that they aren't too serious and over-enthusiastic. That used to scare me. A new producer would come and then they have sheets of paper and they want to take low-angle shot and high-angle shot and this shot and that shot. So we have to break them down. Bring them into our world and show them that this is nothing great, just regular government job, just get on with it. Don't go. But it's good. After a month, they themselves give up their dream of making India's finest feature film. And then they just shoot top 10 with Shehnaz Treasurywala. Camera ready? Lights on? Shoot!
Okay, I think we have answered the next one, but I'll just mention Monisha Badlani, who says, hi, love the show, The Week That Wasn't. How does it come up so fabulously every time? So, thank you. That's for you, Cyrus. So maybe
we had an MTV colleague for a long time called Shali Badlani. I hope they're probably related. the fun with that show is writing it. It's always fun and wondering what will be allowed, you know, what we can get away with. So, but we write separately and then we argue and fight. So there's, we had Ashish Shakir to write for us who joined AIB and then became a superstar and made lots of money. We've had a couple of other writers come and go. And now Kunal and me basically do all the writing ourselves. So that's the fun part more than anything else. Shooting actually takes us 3-4 hours. We're done. But we have to brainstorm about which story can go. For example, we didn't want to get into the Ram Mandir story this week because it was all over and you don't want to poke too much fun because you know there's nowhere to go with that without some trouble coming. But Sushant Singh Rajput's story, I just felt it was being done to death, but we could not touch it because every channel picked it up and it's now a triple murder and a quadruple murder. And I don't know, I think that girl Ria may have even worked with us at MTV because she seems familiar, but correct me if I'm wrong, I'm not sure. But I think maybe we did work with her in the beginning when she was much younger.
Moving to the next section, Cyrus, and that we're running out of time, and you said somebody's working with you. Just before that, you know, we asked a question to the audience and the audience has come back saying, "Jo banta hai, wahi bikta hai." That's how it is. So let's go by the audience.
But you know, the reason the audience has taken it in is because that's what they wanted. You can't say, I don't know, man. You guys know market demand and supply better than all of us. So I don't know. But I don't think you can separate them. I think it's just a circle.
Okay, before I move on to my next section, which is rapid fire, one more question to the audience and specifically my colleagues within HSBC, and this is limited to them as of now. We have people who are customers also here, clients, and also their friends and families who are watching us, but this is limited to HSBC or if others, that one of our own colleagues in HSBC has worked with Cyrus earlier in MTV. If you know who that is, please put that in the question box as an answer. With that, let's move on to our next round, Cyrus.
I want to know.
You'll answer that later when we get the answers.
Will you text me?
Okay. Cyrus, the rapid fire. The rapid is only that I will give you rapidly. You can answer in your own style because that's how you want to hear
that. You're playing the role of Karan Johar. I'm playing the role of the couch.
It's not really funny today to play the role of Karan Johar. It's not really appreciated outside.
That's
anyway,
true.
So
again, the references have been wrong from the beginning. I apologize to your dad's staff. Yeah.
Okay. So the first one, Cyrus as a comedian or a Cyrus as a cricket expert?
Obviously, if I could be a cricket expert, come on. I wake up thinking I'd play for India still. Sometimes I have a deep sleep. Oh. You know, I still wake up thinking, you know, I know as a young man, I should make a field setting and all, you know, people would think I'm mad. Standing in the middle of the road, I'd be like, is that piche? I don't know. I think I'm sick. I think if I get Alzheimer's finally and as I reach my deathbed, I'll just be doing cricket fantasy things in my head.
That's what
I'm saying. Exactly. Do you do that?
Yeah.
So, I'm sure there's a group of us who, in the middle of an important thing, you know, you've got a presentation with a huge client, and in the middle, you just go, for no reason whatsoever. I've done all that, man. So if you're taking guard, there's some Japanese client in the room who's really big and all that. Suddenly take guard and you just see the elbows pointing to cover.
Yeah. In theory, we always want to get it right, right? We want to get the textbook style.
Absolutely.
Wonderful. The next one. Again, taking you back to your when you were 13. Nasiruddin Shah or Pankaj Kapoor?
Pankaj is very introverted and quiet. I didn't really get to know him. He was there only on one of those weekends, but he didn't speak much. Or maybe he spoke with other people. He didn't speak too much. Not like he was unfriendly. He was a nice and friendly guy, but he just kept to himself.
Okay.
Nasir adopted me for some time, so I had a nice relationship with him. And he loves sports. So we discussed cricket, boxing, tennis, weightlifting, because he was into bodybuilding at that point, everything. So
and he's played a cricketer himself also, I think, in one of
the games. He was a very good tennis player. He's crazy about tennis and cricket. But his understanding of all sport, hockey, you ask him, he's damn good. Keep in mind, Anand, the advantage of our generation is, Google nahi tha us samay. We had to remember. So you can just immediately, you know, you've got the name in your head. And Ajit Pal, the great hockey player, tack, you know, it comes to your head like that. Now what? Now the kids will take out the phone, Google. I feel so bad. I could give you county cricket scores in the 80s. Somerset versus Gloucester. He had both of 46 not out. I give the full score after reading it once in Indian Express.
The Wisden book. The Wisden
book. To all that. You know, I know the middle names of all the cricketers, things like that. Now the guy will beat me by pressing a button. I mean, you can do Chamila Vas's name, which is ridiculously long. It's longer than the island of Sri Lanka. It's that long. But, you know, you try and learn it by heart. The other guy will just go and say the whole thing. It's unfair. It's really unfair.
Why? Okay, the next one. Next one, Cyrus.
I talk too much. I apologize. Yeah.
No, not at all. That's what we're here for. Cyrus as a showman or Cyrus as a family man?
So on Loveline, we had this psychiatrist who, because we were getting letters in blood and also after some time, we said, look, how do we deal with these people? My flippant comments are dangerous. We don't want just that. So we had a lady, actually two, who would come on from time to time on this MTV Loveline show. So in the interim, while talking and all that, while waiting to shoot, I would ask her and we get to know her a little better. So I got some free counseling sessions from her and she diagnosed me as an extreme personality. So, and she told me because I used to drink a lot, binge drinking in those days, Friday night. My legendary stories are there, which I can't mention here, but I have some legendary stories. And so she told me, you know, you're an extreme personality. The good thing about that is you can go the other way. You can drink a lot and misbehave and never stop and all that, or you can not do it at all. It'll be easy for you. So I can either be the family guy or I can be the guy who's really the worst behaved in the room. But I just can't be a moderate, sadly. Luckily, that's good for politics now.
I think I'll give a tough one now. The last one of the rapid fire. It's a tough one because it'll be difficult, I'm sure. Rahul Dravid or Virendra Sehwag?
Dravid, for me. Sehwag's fantastic, but he's an I player. You know, there's a lot of luck involved. For me, Dravid. Yeah. Dravid, you got to sleep well at night. Dravid is batting. You know that Dravid is batting. He'll continue to bat. Sehwag will give you nightmares because, you know, over point, over third man. But not to say that I didn't like Sehwag. Fantastic batsman, changed cricket. But Dravid is Dravid. again, I think Dravid deserves more. Like we spoke about Jaspal Bhatti. Dravid deserves more credit for that generation of cricket.
Absolutely.
I mean, all of them are more flamboyant. Sachin Tendulkar is Sachin Tendulkar. Sehwag is, you know, the Buccaneer. Lakshman, the artist. Ganguly, you know, the intrepid Ganguly, the captain, chest out, take on the foreigners. You've got all these guys, Gautam Gambhir. And then Dravid is lost sometimes. But Dravid is the guy who's given you all the great victories. You see how he beat Australia and Australia. By the way, this is digressing into a cricket conversation. Huh? See how quickly that's happened.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so I'm a huge
cricket is life, right? Doesn't matter.
Yeah. I did an ad with him for Pepsi, so
oh.
And then we did a bakra on him as well. And he and Nikhil Chinnappa of MTV worked were in St. Joseph's in Bangalore together for 1 year apart. And so he called up Nikhil, if memory serves me right, and said, please don't air my bakra. And they were going to Zimbabwe where Mahasekhar made 100, I remember. And so he actually was a little worried. I'll get to the gag. In short, was we sent a girl into the trailer while we were shooting the Pepsi ad, and the girl says she wants to marry him. And in the background, we have the father who comes and keeps calling him Sachin, which was really irritating him. Okay, but Sachin, sun to sahi, Sachin, shaadi kar lo, Sachin. And he didn't react to it, but he was getting angry. But he's such a Sharif sort of guy that, you know, he told her, you parai karo, studies karo, homework kar lo. You know, he gave the whole uncle speech. But he was quite rattled for a few minutes. A great guy.
But you know what? Generally, I would have, or many, I think the audience would have also, if I'm not mistaken, would have thought that you would have picked Sehwag. And that you chose Rahul over that clearly says how different you are and what cricket, what passion you have for this game. Because it's a very different class of people who choose Dravid over Sehwag in this case. And that's very different from the Cyrus we know.
I hope we don't define ourselves by those choices. The great thing, I think, about growing up in the 80s, if you were batting, is that when you go forward, you go forward. When you go back, you go back. Nowadays, they have this half cock, which everybody does. They're just slightly forward and slightly back. I don't know, Anand, if you played any cricket, but you know, I remember they would just make you run around Hindu Gymkhana. You know, the coach would punish you. And you had to do rounds if you didn't put your front foot forward and come forward with bat and pad close together and the ball. So again,
yeah,
digressing.
True. So sorry. Now that we are on the touch of the hour and we are losing time, I'm getting hints here that I need to close. You know, Cyrus, on that last note, I think your diverse career has been something very common with HSBC also, because HSBC's new direction has been to celebrate the new India. What we call is India beyond boundaries. And that's how you have seen your life most of the times, breaking stereotypes, taking that extra leap in action and in thoughts over and over again. I think that resonates with us and Cyrus Brocha. Thank you. Thank you for this wonderful evening. This starts a great weekend for all of us. And your on this note, I think it's wonderful that we were able to talk to you today. And with that, and in interest of time, we will close the event for the day. Thank you, everyone. Hope to have you on us on the show next time, next Friday. Till then, thank you.